Hello there, and you are welcome once again to the Light of Life. Have you discovered the purpose of God for your life? Are you making conscious effort towards its realization or fulfillment? Do you know that as a child of God, the events that happen around your life will always work together for the fulfillment of that purpose if you will choose to trust God and walk with Him? Today, I'll be drawing examples from the life of Joseph, and there are lessons for us to learn from it so that we'll be able to cooperate with God towards the fulfillment of His purpose for our lives. Let us pray. Thank you, Father, for another opportunity to go into your word. Speak to us again, O Lord. Give us clarity concerning those things that we may find difficult to understand, and enable us to be empowered to fulfill your purpose for our lives. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. I've come across a couple of people who are not so bothered about the fulfillment of God's purpose for their life. In fact, I've seen people who believe that the most important thing is for them to just make heaven. Every other thing can take the back place. But this is not how God wants us to think. He wants us to be focused on fulfilling the purpose for which He has created us, because it goes beyond us. His purpose is always about us being a blessing unto others. And if we fail to do this, then we'll be depriving others of some of the benefits or the kind of impact that we should have on their lives, so that the purpose of God for their own lives too can be fulfilled. More so, the gifts or the rewards that are available for believers is only for those who serve the purpose of God for their life diligently. Therefore, if you truly are desirous of a crown by the time our Lord Jesus Christ will be appearing, it is important that you discover the purpose of God for your life and work very diligently towards its realization or fulfillment. Being someone that fulfills the purpose of God for your life is not necessarily as difficult as many people think it is. You are never going to get the full picture at once. But if you will walk step by step with God, you would be able to discover that in due time, before you realize it, you are already functioning in line with His plan and purpose for your life, so much that you'll be ready to receive a due reward by the time He shows up. Looking at the life of Joseph, there are seven major things that we can see from it that I'll be drawing your attention to today, that you too can look at in your life, that will help you plot a path from where you are so that you'll be able to fulfill the purpose of God for your life as well. The first thing that we're going to be looking at is the abundance of the love of his father towards him. If you read the book of Genesis chapter 37, which is where most of the things that we're going to be talking about today will be coming from, you will see that the Bible makes it clear that Jacob loved Joseph very well. The love that Jacob had, for Joseph was so great that all of his siblings began to envy him. Joseph was the son of his old age because it took a while before Rachel had children, and his firstborn was Joseph. And then as at this time that we're talking about in Genesis chapter 37, Rachel had already died. And Rachel being the love of the life of Jacob, Jacob poured all of his love upon the two sons that she had for him before she died. That is Joseph and Benjamin. So we see clearly how much Jacob loved Joseph. For you, this reminds you how much the Father loves you, and that how much He lavishes that His love on you. For the sake of Christ, because of that which Christ has done on the cross of Calvary, when God looks at you, He sees Christ, and therefore He pours his love on you. It is important that you know this, because in the pursuit of God's will for your life, there'll be times that you will run to things that look like dead ends. You will come to times when things will look very, very difficult for you. But when you understand how much God loves you and how unconditional his love is, it will be easy for you to endure whatever it is that you are going through at that point in time, because you know that he would never leave you nor forsake you. It's a promise that he made to us, and he would never go back upon. He loved us even before we loved him. The Apostle John says that the only reason why we are able to love him is because he first loved us. So when you know this, irrespective of what the situation in your life may be, no matter what it is that is working or not working, if you have a revelation of the love of God, you will be able to endure and push through until you are able to get to where God wants you to get to. The consciousness of the love of God is very, very important. It is an anchor for the soul. Jacob loved Joseph with the whole of his heart. God loves you with the whole of his heart. The Bible makes it clear to us that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. See, God commended his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He said, he who spared not his only begotten Son, but freely gave him unto us, how much more will he also freely give us all things with him? So that love is so great that God was willing to allow his only begotten Son to die on the cross for you and I. He did not have to do it, but because of his commitment to us, because of his love that is deep, that is strong, that is unconditional, he did those things. So that's why the apostle says, oh, how great the depth of the love of God. It is unsearchable. It is something that goes beyond what we can comprehend with our mind. It goes beyond what our emotions can capture or express. The love of God is the anchor for our soul, and it's something that you need to hold on fast to. David said, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for your rod and your staff, they comfort me. He says, I fear no evil because you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. God loved him, and he was aware of it, and he lavished that love upon himself. He received that love. It wasn't that God just gave it. He too received it and enjoyed it to the best of his abilities. Jesus Christ said it over and over. He said the Father loved him. So you too should be aware of that God loves you. Take your mind off the things that may seem not to be working in your life. Take your mind off the situations that seem to be discouraging in your life. Let the love of God be the anchor for your soul. Let it be the thing that would always let you go on, because he has promised that he would never leave you nor forsake you. And he has done that for others. He's not going to change his word on your case. God loves you, and that must be number one thing that you must always hold on to. The Father's love remains with us forever. The second thing that we can also see in the life of Joseph is that he was a man with weaknesses. We saw that he was somebody that talked too much. He was naive. He was somebody that was a talebearer, would go and look at his brothers, see the things that they are doing wrong, and come and report to his father. He was so naive that he had a dream. He was telling it to his brothers. His brothers were angry, and he still told them the dream the more. That was how naive he was. He could not even pick the fact that these guys are upset with him, and that the only reason why they had not lynched him was because they knew that their father loved him. So that was how naive he was. And he talked too much Talking, things that you should be quiet about. You had a dream and a vision that God gave you, and then you start talking about it to people, even those who didn't care about you. So in the same way, we have weaknesses, every single one of us. But those weaknesses, notwithstanding, are not enough to remove us from the love of God. Paul says, what shall separate us from the love of God? He says nothing. By the time he listed all of those things, he says, and we are persuaded that nothing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. So no matter what your weaknesses are, there are things you need to work on. Please work on those things, because you should not just begin to relish those weaknesses or celebrate them or begin to remain in them and say, God loves me, so I'm just going to continue in these weaknesses. No, you need to work on the things that you can work on, and the ones that you can turn to strength, you turn them to your strength eventually, as we also saw in the life of Joseph. But you must understand that having a weakness is not enough for God to cut you out of his plan and purpose for your life. You should understand that according to Apostle Paul, his strength is made perfect in your weaknesses. John had weakness. He wasn't the only one that had weakness. Virtually everyone that God used had one weakness or the other that manifested in different forms. Moses was a man that was a stammerer. He stuttered. God did not heal him, yet God still used him to accomplish his purpose for his life. Peter was a man that was always quick to talk. Many a times he would talk even before he started thinking about what he had even said, but God still used him to accomplish his purpose for his life. So all you need to do is learn how to yield your weaknesses, your inadequacies unto God, and embrace his strength so that he can do what he wants to do in your life. But never disqualify yourself, no matter what people say concerning you, no matter how much people try to discredit you or disqualify you. No. That those weaknesses, God knows that they are there and he has not rejected you. Therefore, you should not, because of those ones, reject yourself. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, the third thing that we also see about his life is that he was a man that was envied by his brothers. This is very important for us to know, because many of the people that you will first of all have to deal with in the pursuit of the purpose of God for your life are those of your immediate family. And when I say immediate family, I'm talking about majorly the family of God. Some of the people that will criticize and attack and condemn you and despise you are most likely going to be those of the household of faith. If you get so disappointed or discouraged to the point that you give up on your dream or the pursuit of God purpose for your life, you would have done yourself a lot of harm, because this is part of the package. Just like the brothers of Joseph envied him, the people in your church, in your immediate family, are likely going to be the ones that will first of all have no confidence in you. It happened to our Lord Jesus Christ, because when he came to his own, Bible says that even his own rejected him. That's what the Bible tells us in the book of John chapter 1. I think verse 11 says he came unto his own, but his own rejected him. He says, but to as many as received him, even to them that believed on him, he gave power to become sons of God. He says that a prophet is not without honor, except in his own country, among his people, and in his own family, in his own house. So you need to understand that. Bible began by telling us that the enemies of a man are those of his household. So it does not mean that they are witches or wizards. It just means that at some point, they would not have confidence in you. Even those that came out of the same womb with Jesus Christ did not believe in him at first. If you read through the Gospels, you would see that. When in the book of Luke chapter 4, he went, after reading in Luke chapter 4 verse 17, quoting the scriptures that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the poor and all of those things, and he read those things, those people looked at him and said, who are you? What do you think you are? They didn't believe in him. And they drove him away from the place. He had to run to Capernaum for him to be able to continue his ministry. So the people closest to you, especially those of the household of faith, are going to be your first opponents. Those who will do it, in most cases, because of their immaturity, their lack of ability to handle the manifestation of the grace of God on your life, it will cause you certain kinds of problems. So you must be prepared to deal with that. Don't hate them because of that. Don't despise them. Jesus Christ prayed for the Jews after they had nailed him to the cross. He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. He still kept loving them. In spite of everything that they did to Apostle Paul, he still continued praying for them. He was even saying that he wished that he was accursed for the sake of his brothers, the Jews. And these guys never for once supported him. They made life practically a living hell for him. But he was able to look beyond those things that those guys were doing because he knew that they had no idea, no clue what they were doing. So don't expect that you're going to get fans immediately from amongst the people around you. It is part of the package, and it's something that you must learn to deal with. Don't also forget that some of those things may be caused by also your immaturity as well. So don't just put the blame on them. Just sometimes see it as a reaction from them sometimes, maybe because of your handling of issues sometimes. But know that no matter how envious they may be of you, that is not going to stop you from being able to fulfill the purpose of God for your life. They may think that they are pushing you out of the place that you think you are comfortable in to be able to fulfill the purpose of God for your life, not knowing that they will drive you to the place that God has actually prepared, because that was what happened for somebody like Joseph. He thought that it was going to be in his father's house and all of those things were going to be achieved. But if God showed him in the vision that he was going to be a leader, an administrator, and his father did not even give him any responsibility at home, how then is he going to be a leader? So God used the envy of his brothers to push him into a place where he became a slave and responsibilities were given unto him. And you would discover that from that point onwards, especially in Genesis chapter 39, the Bible says that the grace of God began to manifest in his life. From that point onwards, the Lord was with him and he was a prosperous man. It's only a man that has responsibility or that is handling something that you describe as prosperous, not the one that is just being a talebearer to the father. You don't prosper in being a gossip. Praise the Lord. So all the things that happened, all the envy of his brothers, everything still worked together for his good. What you are going through or you will go through will end up working together for your good as well. Praise the name of the Lord. So the fourth thing you must also be aware of is that he has an absolute commitment to his father. Excuse me, what do I mean by this? Joseph understood that his father loved him and responded to his father's love by serving him. He did not take undue advantage of the father's love or take the grace that he enjoyed with his father as a liberty to become a spoiled brat. No. His father gave him an assignment to go to his brothers and check on them and see how they are doing. And he got up and went to do it. He even got to where he thought they would be, and those guys were not there. And he still went to where they gave him instructions that those guys would be. He could have turned back home if he was a lazy person. But because he had a sense of responsibility, he still went ahead to where they told him that his brothers were. And he found them there. And of course, before he could deliver the message, they had sold him into slavery. But that was what kickstarted the process of him being able to fulfill the purpose of God for his life. So you need to understand that the love of God compels you to respond to his service. The love of God towards you is not something that you just enjoy and tell people about. It must move you to serve him. The best that God has is not for those who he loves. It's for those who love him. He says in Romans 8 verse 28, that which is our anchor text for this passage, that all things work together for good for them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. Not them that the Lord loves. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 9 says, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, nor has it come into the hearts of man what God has prepared for them that love him. Psalm 91 says, because he has set his love on me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. That is the word of God. So it is not just that God loves you. God wants you to respond by loving him back. And how do you express that love for him? By obeying his commandments and carrying out the duties and the responsibilities that he commits into your hand. Your heart must be out to serve the Father, to do the will of God. Just like Joseph was willing to do the will of his father, he set out to deliver the message. What is the message that God has sent you with to your generation? Are you paying attention to it, or you are just the type that goes to church only to ask for the things that you want from God without thinking about what you can actually do to serve God? So you need to have that consciousness and the desire to go the extra mile to ensure that God's kingdom comes on earth. He says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all other things shall be added unto you. You must prioritize the purpose of God above every other thing if you want his will for your life to find expression. Hallelujah. Now, the fifth thing that we see about Joseph is that he had certain personal qualities that worked towards him being able to fulfill the purpose of God for his life. The first that we see in him was that he was an administrator. He had a skill that he deployed actively, and that helped him to fulfill the purpose of God for his life. He was an administrator in Potiphar's house. He was an administrator in the prison. He was also an administrator as a prime minister, second to Pharaoh in the land of Egypt. And he did those duties. He handled those responsibilities well. So you need to know how to develop the skill that God has given unto you, because that skill would always grant you audience with the ones that God has sent you to. The Bible says that the gifts of a man makes room for him and brings him before kings and not just before mean men. The purpose of the gift of God in your life is to create attraction in you from your audience, from the ones that he has sent you to. He makes them he draws them towards you, or creates audience with them, so that you can have access to them and they can have access to you, and then you are now able to fulfill that purpose that he wants you to fulfill. So you need to develop the skill that God has given unto you. He needs it, and that's why he gave it to you to serve him with. The second thing about Joseph is that he was a man of integrity. He was committed to everything that his master told him to do, and he handled it so well that his master was at peace. He committed everything into his hands, whether it was in the field or even it was at home. All the resources that the man had, he gave them all to him because he saw integrity in him. This was something that was good to him. You need to walk in integrity, because it's going to be part of the things that God will use to order yourself. The Bible says that the integrity of the upright shall guide them. Your integrity is going to be one of the things that God will use to bring you into the purpose that He has created to you, for you, even if that integrity gets you into problems, just like He did for Joseph. Because if Joseph had not been a man of integrity, he would have laid down with the wife of Potiphar, and he would have just remained a slave in the house of Potiphar. He would have died a slave. But because he stood as a man of integrity in the house of Potiphar and refused to do that evil thing, the wicked thing that the woman wanted her to do, he landed in prison. And from the prison, he ended up being in the palace. So the wickedness of that woman actually ended up plotting a path for him to get where God wants him to get to. So you need to walk in integrity, no matter what it is going to cost you, because it is part of the things that God will use to promote you. The three Hebrew kids got promoted because they refused to bow down to the idol, even if it was going to cost them their lives. Daniel got promoted because he refused to bow down and compromise, even if it was going to cost him being put in the lion's den. It was a test for him, and he passed it, the integrity test. And that set them up and put them in the place of influence. You need to know that for yourself as well, if you are going to fulfill the purpose of God for your life. Another thing we see in the life of Joseph is his sensitivity to the needs of others. Being in the house, or being in the prison, he had the ability to interpret dreams. But nobody knew. It was because he saw the dullness in the countenance of the baker and the butler, and he showed concern. It was because of that that those guys told him their dreams. It's not like they knew that he was a dream interpreter and they went to meet him. He showed concern, and then that was what set him up for him being in the palace in the first place, because it was the dream that he interpreted for the butler that the butler remembered when Pharaoh had the same kind of problem, and he ended up recommending him, and before you realize it, he was in the palace. So you must learn to be sensitive to the needs of others. It is something that God would also use to help you get to where God wants you to get to. The fifth thing we also see in his life is that he was a beautiful, he was a good looking man. The Bible describes him as well favored. That's the King James Version. He was good looking. Why is this important? It does not mean that you have to have any extra look, as in you have to be exceptionally beautiful before you can fulfill the purpose of God for your life. No. But God made reference to this so that you will know that if people are making reference to the fact that you look beautiful, that you have good looks, the God that gave it to you has a plan for it. And that's why you should not let it lead you astray and cause you to begin to do things that you are not supposed to do with it. There are men that want to corrupt it and make you do things that are contrary to the will of God with it, just like we saw in the case of Potiphar's wife. You understand? It was that good look. After all, I'm sure he was not the only one in the house of Potiphar, but it was the good look that he had that made him attractive to Potiphar's wife. And then, because he refused, he ended up in prison. Remember that it was the good looks of Esther that qualified her to be part of those that would contest for the position of Vashti. The grace of God came upon that beauty. That was what that grace worked with. So if she had despised her beauty and had not stepped forward when they were looking for people who would be queen for the king, she would never have been in a position to influence the king to stop Haman from wreaking the havoc that he wanted to wreak upon the land, or as in upon the Jews who were in Persia at that point in time. So if you have good looks, just know that it's a gift from God, and it could be instrumental in Him leading you to the place that He wants you to be, or achieving the purpose. So don't ever despise it. You understand? You have no reason whatsoever to apologize to anybody for being good looking. It is a gift from God, and you use it to the glory of His name. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. So those are His personal qualities that we see that are very good at helping get to where He's going. Another one that I would like to end with, and talking about His qualities, is His commitment to personal improvement. When he was in Potiphar's house, Joseph was an administrator. By the time he got into prison, he was not just an administrator, he was also a dream interpreter. He had added another virtue to it. By the time he was appearing before Pharaoh, he was not just a good administrator. He wasn't just someone that was able to interpret dreams. Now he could proffer solution on how to practically handle the interpretation of dreams. He didn't do that for the baker and the butler. So he kept improving in his capacity. And that was one of the things that helped him. Because if you remember, what Pharaoh responded to was not just his ability to interpret dreams. It was also because he had the ability to say, this is what is going to be done. And that was what Pharaoh said, now this is what you are going to do for us. You know what to do, therefore you be the one coordinating it, becoming second to me in the land of Egypt. And all the chiefs and the elders in the land of Egypt then agreed with him on that. So you need to be committed to personal improvement. God wants you to continue to increase. He says in capacity, he says the path of the just is like the shining light that shines more and more unto the perfect day. Your yesterday will recommend you for today, but it is what today meets in your hand that would recommend you for tomorrow. Your yesterday will recommend you for your today, but it is what today meets with you that will determine whether you are ready for your tomorrow or not. The ability to interpret dreams recommended Joseph, for Pharaoh, but it was the ability of Joseph to profile solution that made him relevant to that day for Pharaoh, to the point that he was able to make him the prime minister in the land of Egypt. Praise the name of the Lord. So we also see in the life of Joseph that there were certain things that happened around him that led to him being able to fulfill his purpose. The problems around, he knew how to respond to it. He had a heart that responded to problems. He did not see a problem and run away from it. He was able to face challenges head on and find solutions to them. He confronted issues headlong and found solutions to them. You will see that when the people kept coming to him in the land of Egypt, saying, all our money has finished, he said, okay, go and bring your animals. Our animals have finished, he said, okay, bring your land. Our lands are finished and we don't have anything. Okay, I'm going to give you seed, cultivate it, bring us a particular percentage, and that becomes tax in the land. He was able at every stage to respond to the problems of the people, because he had a heart that was committed to the people. So these are the things that made Joseph very much able to fulfill the purpose of God for his life. And when you look at your life too, you ask yourself, how are you responding to problems? Jesus responded to the problem of mankind, and he was able to bring us salvation. Paul responded to the problem of the Gentile church and was able to take the gospel unto them. So There are problems in our world that God wants us to find solutions to. David responded to the problem that Israel was having at that point in time. They were all confronting Goliath. For 40 days, God had been boasting, and none of them could stand up to him. And David said, I'm going to handle this. You understand? And that problem that was in his society, in the world at that point in time, was what changed everything for him. And then he was able to get to where God wanted him to get to. The same thing in the life of Daniel. Everybody was going to be killed, but he said they should give him 3 days, just three more days. And then he went in, sought the face of God, and found the solution. So if you are going to fulfill the purpose of God for your life, you must be centered on solving problems. Our life is about being a blessing. It's about solving problems for our generation. That is what God wants our life to be about. That is what the purpose that God wants us to serve is all about. And I urge you to look at all of these points and be determined in your mind. They are going to look at where it applies to you and see how you will use it to fulfill the purpose of God for your life. I believe you have been greatly blessed by this teaching today. And it's my prayer that as you apply all of these principles, you'll be able to come to the place where what God wants for you becomes that which is realized, not just a dream, but something that becomes fulfilled eventually. God bless you. Let us pray. Thank you, Father, for your word that has come to be a blessing unto us today. Let this word produce abundant fruits in our hearts, and let it enable us fulfill that which you have called us to do, that we may be worthy of the rewards that you have prepared for us at the end of the day. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. God bless you, and see you next week.